Good afternoon and warm greetings to all invited guests, dignitaries, participants, colleagues, and friends. On behalf of Kandalu Shala, an institution dedicated for higher learning and research in ancient Indian wisdom, welcomes you to the National Lecture Series on Indian Intellectual Traditions. This is the eighth lecture. Today we are discussing about a unique topic, Indian theories of meaning, Punyani Raja's critique. And we have with us a young Vedi scholar, a poet, writer, and musician, Dr. S.V. Arambiya, Assistant Professor of Sanskrit in NG College, Trivandrum. So let us start the function with the invocation. Now I invite Kumari Durga S. Nambudri to do the Vedic invocation. I don't know whether she is here.
Otherwise, you can invite Dr. Preeti.
Yeah, we are very fortunate to have with us another professor, Dr. K. Preeti. She is the head of music department of C. Shankaracharya University. Let us invite her to do the Vedic invocation.
Achyutam Keshavam Ramanarayanam Krishna Damodaram Vasudevam Harim Sridharam Madhavam Gopika Vallabham Janaki Nayakam Ramachandram Bhaje Achyutam Keshavam Satyabhamadhavam Madhavam Sridharam Radhika Radhitam Indira Mandiram Chetasa Sundaram Devaki Nandanam Nandajam Sandhave Vishnave Jishnave Shankhine Chakrine Rukmini Ragine Janaki Janaye Vallavi Vallabhaya Archidayatmane Kamsavi Dvamsine Vamshine Te Nama Krishna Govinda He Rama Narayana Shripate Vasudevajita Srinidhe Achyutananda He Madhavadhokshaja Dwaraka Nayaka Draupadi Rakshaka Rakshasa Kshobhita Sitaya Shobhito Dandakaranya Bhupunyata Karana Lakshmane Nanvito Vanarai Sevito Agastya Sampujito Raghava Patumam Dhenukarishtago Nishtagr Dveshinam Keshihakam Sahrad Vamshika Vadaka Putana Shoshaka Suraja Khelano Balago Balaka Patumam Sarvada Vidyuta Dyotavad Praspuradvasasam Pravridam Bodhavad Prolasad Vigraham Vanyayamalaya Chobhitorasthalam Lohitangridvayam Varijaksham Bhaje Kunjitai Kundalair Vrajamanananam Ratnamaulim Lasad Kundalam Gandayo Harakeyurakam Kangana Prujvalam Kingini Manjulam Shyamalam Tam Bhaje Achyutasyashtagam Yappadedishtadam Premata Pratyaham Purusha Sastritam Vrittada Sundaram तस्य वशो हरिर्जायते सत्वरम्।
That was a melodious invocation by Dr. K. Preethi, the head of Department of Music. Now I invite Dr. Sharida Maheshwaran, the head of Department Sanskrit, Government Sanskrit College, Tirupunithura, to deliver the welcome address.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon to one and all assembled here for the 8th National Lecture Series on Indian Intellectual Tradition conducted by Kandallur Shala. Today's topic for the lecture series is Indian Theories of Meaning, Kunjunni Raja's Critic, presented by Dr. S.V. Aryambiga. I, Dr. Sarita Maheshwaran, am here to welcome the guests of honors for today's session. Respected Chair, our beloved teacher and all in all of Kandallur Shala, Dr. P.C. Murali Madhavan sir, who is the Director in Chief of Kandallur Shala. So I extend a warm welcome to you, sir. Next, I extend a hearty welcome to Dr. S.V. Aryambiga, Assistant Professor in Sanskrit, Mahatma Gandhi College, Thiruvananthapuram, as well as she is a poet and an active writer in Malayalam. She has been honored with the national level award Yuva Puraskar from Kendra Sahitya Academy. She has conquered more than 11 state awards. Hearty welcome to Aryambiga, my dear sister. So welcome Aryambiga. I also welcome Dr. Ajitan PI, who is delivering the vote of thanks. And next, I would like to welcome Dr. Vanaja V.S., Assistant Professor of Sanskrit, Vimala College, Thrissur, for presenting citation on this occasion. Lastly, I extend a hearty welcome to all of them, Pradeep sir, and all of them who have summoned here to participate and support this program. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Sharida. And now I welcome and invite our Director-in-Chief, Kandallur Shala, Dr. P.C. Murali Madhavan, to do the presidential address. Over to Dr. P.C. Madhavan.
Dear Dr. Aryambiga, the Chief Speaker of the day, Dr. Pradeep Jodi, the life member of the trust, Kandallur Sabha Trust, and also treasurer and the IT advisor of Kandallur Sabha, the beloved members of the Kandallur Sabha and Shala, scholars and students participating this event on virtual platform, Dr. Vanaja, who is presenting their citation, Dr. Sarita, who delivered the welcome speech, Dr. K. Preethi, who presented the beautiful invocation. I welcome one and all to this August assembly of virtual platform to attend the lecture delivered by Dr. S.V. Aryambiga. Today the subject is Dr. K. Kunjunni Raja and his magnum opus work named Indian Theories of Meaning. The day I joined as a student of Madras University, some 5 decades back, for my postgraduate studies, I happened to see a professor in the chair in the Department of Sanskrit who looked shyly across the piles of books and papers that crowded to his desk. When my father, late Professor P.C. Vasudevan Iyer, introduced him, I could never guess at the impressive honors and credentials tagged to his name. Gradually, I could visualize the meaning of the famous verse of Mahakavi Kalidasa, Agara Sadrusha Pratnyaha, Pratnyaya Sadrusha Agamaha, Agamai Sadrusha Arambha, Arambha Sadrusha Udayaha. I full the spirit of this verse fully in Professor K. Kunjunaraja. The professor mentioned here is none other than the late Dr. K. Kunjunaraja, who happened to be the Kulapati in the field of Indological studies. He always claims to be a student of Sanskrit and not as a professor of Sanskrit. Vinayatva and Vinayatva were the two striking features of his character, which are exemplary. In scholarship, he was a worthy successor of Professor C. Kunjanraja, his own uncle, and the scholar of international repute, Professor V. Raghavan, his predecessors. The great tradition of the Department of Sanskrit in Madras University was well protected and made more meaningful by Professor K. Kunjunaraja with his scholastic pursuits. After his demise in 2004, we could institute an academy in his name, the institution named Kunjunaraja Academy of Indological Research. And as one of the workers of that institute, I got abundant help from his family, especially from his children, my friend Sri Girish Paliyat and Dr. Radhika, and also from his relatives. Sri Paliyat is the honorary secretary at present of this academy. Professor Kunjunaraja was born at the well-known Kumaragam Palace, royal family, at Trichur, Kerala, on 2nd February 1920. His father was a Vedic and Tantric scholar, Neelakandhan Nambudiri by name, and mother Kavu Tamburati. He had his early education according to the traditional system. Due to the extraordinary brilliance and grasping power, he was known in the childhood as Midukan Tamburan. He took his BA degree in mathematics and later turned to Sanskrit for his postgraduate and doctoral studies. In the childhood, his long stay with his own poet uncle, the well-known late K.K. Raja, Kavi K.K. Raja, brought him into contact with the literary world. Dr. Raja served as a lecturer in Sanskrit in colleges at Chittoor, Palakkad, and Ernakulam for nearly 4 years. And he is fortunate to receive instructions under erudite scholars like C. Kunjanraja, V. Raghavan, and Mahamahobadhyaya Kupuswami Shastri. He took his first doctoral degree from Madras University on the topic The Contribution of Kerala to Sanskrit Literature. The findings that Professor Raja unveiled more than 7 decades back, remains unchallenged and still continue to be the basic documents to the researchers of Kerala Sanskrit Literature. This is something very unique and very rarely happen in research world. Normally in research, every year, every month, every day perhaps, the findings of a scholar will be changed. It will be totally changed, or sometimes it will be improvised. But this is, as far as Raja is concerned, even after 70 years, his finding stands unique and it is unquestioned and unchallenged. In his review of contribution of Kerala to Sanskrit literature, Rajaspi's dissertation, Dr. V. Raghavan holds the opinion that Kunjunda Raja excels Mahakavi Ullur S. Parameswarayyar and the great Sanskrit literary historian Vadakkangur Rajaraja Varma, since he has adopted an impartial research-oriented path for tracing the authorship and the chronology of the works belonging to Kerala literature, Kerala Sanskrit literature. It is a known fact that the above-mentioned predecessors, that is Ullur and Vadakkangur of Raja, bestowed their attention more on literary merits of the work of the works. Whenever they find out, trace out, or unearth new manuscripts, they find the literary merits, they inquire the literary merits of those works, but they are very little scared about the its authorship, its the real, to finding out, find out the real author, and also its what we call the period of its composition. And so the authorship and chronology were neglected. But this is a very important aspect as far as Sanskrit research is concerned. The veteran scholar, late N.V. Krishnavarya, remarks correctly that in this field, he has done excellent work. With diligence and patience, he has gathered his data from unpublished manuscripts, and with intuition and knack has sifted correctly and evolved a connected pattern out of this apparently disjoint material. So these are some remarks of some scholars about his first thesis, submitted in Madras University, named The Contribution of Kerala to Sanskrit Literature. British Council, in an unusual program, sponsored Dr. K. Kunjuni Raja for his second PhD, a postdoctoral work in Sanskrit from London University. There he worked under Professor John Bruff, a well-known linguist, and submitted his thesis titled Indian Theories of Meaning. The purpose of this work is to bring out in a systematic form the linguistically relevant views on the different aspects of meaning given by the various scholars of thought in ancient India. Professor Fristall, in his review of his book on this Indian Theories of Meaning, states that Dr. Raja, a Sanskrit scholar who is well trained in Western linguistics, under Professor John Bruff and also Professor Frith, believes that problems of meaning and linguistic analysis are of fundamental importance and were treated in this spirit by Indian theoreticians. In Kunjuni Raja's analysis, the more his investigation progresses, the more mysticism is deflated. No better account of the theory of Spoda is there than the one offered by Dr. Raja. The Spoda doctrine, divested of all mystical elements, advocated by Bhartrihari, emphasizes the importance considering the sentence, which is the only a complete utterance. That is an indivisible language symbol. Professor Raja's contribution in the form of this thesis can be recommended unhesitatingly to anyone interested in semantics. Kunjuni Raja's work will continue to demonstrate that Indian theories of meaning are both intrinsically interesting and decidedly relevant to contemporary semantics. Professor Raja records that Bhartrihari, Professor Raja records that Bhartrihari's view of double power of a word is acceptable. It can convey idea of the form of an expression as well as its content. He says, language is similar to light and consciousness in so far as it can reveal itself and also reveal other things. Light will reveal itself and it will shed light on other objects and it will reveal others also, other things also. There is no doubt that the potency of a word, the word is like that. It's just like light. There is no doubt that the potency of a word fails to be effective without the great force of what is now called communication. Each word has meaning, not because meaning has been arbitrarily assigned to it, but because it contains the meaning of the concrete situations in which it participates. The word and the thing are not discrete elements to be related by the speaker. They are interdependent. Dr. Raja holds that Sanskrit works on philosophy of grammar are almost overloaded with descriptions of meaning as relation. All the schools of thought have assumed a direct relationship between Shabda and Artha. But if this were so, what was the purpose of setting up the Indian concept of meaning as a rectangle? You know, Shabda, then Vritti, then Artha. So this triangle exists. Vritti, or the function of a word, is its relation to the sense. This relation being considered as a power residing in the word which enables it to denote the sense. This pragmatic approach is very frequently revealed by their paramount importance given to vyavahara or communication being a happy correlative of modern views of language. Trends of Indian approaches to meaning discussed by Professor Raja deserve serious attention. The illuminating discussions made by him opened new vistas of semantic world. The ancient and medieval thought of India on semantics is well analyzed microscopically to the extent possible. In this context, Professor Raja deals with the contradictory theories of Kumarila Bhatta and Prabhakara, the pioneers in Mimamsa. Bhatta Mimamsa and Prabhakara Mimamsa. Kumarila holds the view that none can understand the meaning of a sentence without a previous understanding of the meaning of individual words. Moreover, if the meaning of a sentence were quite interdependent of the meaning of its constituent words, then any sentence would convey any meaning. But Prabhakara holds entirely a different theory, since he resorts the sentence as the pivot of human speech. Thus, Prabhakara says that all usage is through the sentence and its meaning. The relation that sentence bears to its meaning is permanent. This is an altogether different approach from Kumarila Bhatta. Professor Raja discusses these two approaches in detail along with other theories of Indian thought and arrives at the conclusion that there will be no two opinions on the fact that the word is the pivot of human speech. The author could easily arrive at the point based on the data presented by him. It is the context, metaphysical, epistemological, or pragmatic, which should be the final umpire in the judgment of the matter. Professor Siddheshwara Varma, in his review on Indian theories of meaning, reveals how skillfully Dr. Raja presents the logical propriety of the Indian Mimamsaka thought on class, that is jati, and individual, vyakti, as the content of meaning. Mimamsaka believes that the primary meaning of a word is universal, which is the essential quality common to the particular instances of the class. Dr. Raja states that from logical point of view, the Mimamsaka seems to be more valid. The semantic environments discussed by Professor Raja needs special mention. It raised the intellectual status of our country. Conditions of knowing the meaning of a sentence were discussed in this treatise in detail. That an utterance is an organic whole, which is quite different from a mere summation of individual words, has been handled here for the first time for the linguistic, from the linguistic point of view. So the organic nature of human utterance requires a careful analysis of the semantic factors which unit the different words. It is in the view of this that the categories akanksha, that is natural expectancy, yogyata, that is consistency, etc., have been so exhaustively elucidated by the author of the book, Raja. Siddheshwara Varma says the depth with which the author has investigated these semantic environments could be gauged from his discussion on yogyata. Here, he carefully points out the difference between linguistic and logical compatibility. The fact that the compatibility with the actual facts does not prevent verbal comprehension by only the validity of knowledge, which he accepts from Kumarila Bhatta, made the discussion fruitful. I just want to give some special peculiar aspects of the Indian theories of meaning, some special characteristics of the Indian theories of meaning, some unique contribution of the some points only. Dr. Aryambiga will be explaining the detailed aspects of the maybe brooding over more on the subject and giving more details in each aspect. Here, actually, Raja spoke much about authentically on Spoda. The theory of Spoda received a very significant role in the hands of Dr. Kunjune Raja. I think all these things will be explaining by Dr. S. V. Aryambiga. Dr. Kunjune Raja wrote more than 30 books and published more than 200 research papers on the various Indological aspects. He was the editor of the prestigious volume of Catalogus Catalogorum, the prestige the publication published by University of Madras. At Adyar, he is the editor of the Adyar Library Bulletin for a long time. He has edited numerous books in Sanskrit and Malayalam and embellished several unique works with his scholarly introductions. His critical reviews on books in a series, it has come already published by Brahmavidya, the research journal of Adyar Library. And all these things reveal the depth of his insight and scholarship. The readers could easily see from the many papers that how varied was Professor Raja's scholarly interest, how varied it is. the clarity of his vision, the accuracy of his treatment, and the brevity of his explanation are no doubt ideal, worthy emulating by young research scholars. The doctoral students of Sanskrit as a whole are indebted to this great intellectual giant, Professor K. Kunjuniraja, who made his surname Midukan Thamburan meaningful. With these observations, as a student of Professor K. Kunjuniraja, I am very proud to say that I am a student of Dr. Kunjuniraja, and perhaps I am the only person who is in Kerala who now who can claim as the direct student of Professor K. Kunjuniraja. Dr. K.N. Ilayad is also a student of Dr. K. Kunjuniraja. He has specialized in Vedanta, and I am fortunate to study specialized Sahitya, the classical works like Dhunyaloka, Rasagangadhara, such Alangara Kaustubha, such great monumental works under Dr. Kunjuniraja. And I pay homage to my guru, Professor K. Kunjuniraja, and with these observations. And I want to make it explicitly clear that Dr. S. V. Aryambika has done her research in the contributions of Dr. K. Kunjuniraja to Sanskrit. With these observations, I beg to remain. Thank you for your patient hearing. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Murli Madhavan, our chief of Kandilu Shala, and he is presently the director in chief and the special officer looking after the Kandilu Shala activities. For your very great introductory remarks and presenting his guru, a great scholar, Kunjuniraja, and his works and contributions with his words of wisdom, and set the stage for Dr. Aryambika. And now let us invite Dr. S. V. Aryambika, a young scholar. As I mentioned earlier, she is a poet, great writer, and recipient of Kendra Sahitya Academy Award, Puraskar, and we are eagerly waiting for your fascinating lecture. Dr. Aryambika, please.
सदाशिवसमारंभं शंकराचार्यमध्यमां अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वंदे गुरुपरंपरां। डॉक्टर पीसी मुरलीमाधवन सर, डायरेक्टर एंड चीफ ऑफ कांदलूर शाला, माय बिलवड टीचर Dr. Sarita Maheshwaran, my dear friend, sister, Dr. Ajitan, my dear friend, Dr. Vanaja, my friend, Dr. Pradeep Jyoti sir, other dignitaries of this event, dear teachers and my students, Sarvebhyo Sadara Pranama. Thank you, Murli Madhavan sir, for presenting a scholarly introduction to the topic. Let me read the paper, Indian Theories of Meaning, Kunjuniraja's Critique. Ancient Indian systems of knowledge comprises of several live, subtle, live concepts of language behavior. Meaning is the nucleus of communication, whether it is verbal or non-verbal. Analyzing the layers of meaning is the understanding of the linguistic peculiarities of that language. Dr. K. Kunjuniraja wrote a lot on linguistics, especially on semantics, the branch of knowledge on meaning. The works of Raja, like Indian Theories of Meaning, Mimamsa Contribution to Language Studies, and The Language of Poetry are discussing Indian views on meaning. Among them, Indian Theories of Meaning is the most prominent and authentic work. This paper inquires how Raja has perceived Indian theories of meaning and how effectively he presented and placed them in a modern system of knowledge. Sanskrit and linguistics. Indian culture is built upon the foundation of thoughts on language. Modern linguistics emerged from the detailed study of Sanskrit lore. When the Western scholars began to learn it seriously, they realized the linguistic possibilities and peculiarities of Sanskrit. They also noticed the close relation of Sanskrit to Greek and Latin. This resulted in the commencement of comparative philology, the earlier form of linguistics. The celebrated speech of Sir William Jones on the third annual session of Asiatic Society at Calcutta is considered as the commencement of comparative philology. The development of linguistics was through the historical and comparative methodologies. It was Paninian Sanskrit grammar that guided the Western linguists to analyze the linguistic peculiarities of languages like Greek and Latin. They endorsed the structure of Panini's grammar as a good example of descriptive linguistics. To quote M.B. Emineu, in linguistic matters, the West has only been self-conscious about the canons of description for some decades now. Panini's description of Sanskrit, on the other hand, is an exemplification of how linguistic description should follow scientific canons, and as a model of what should be attempted, it has not yet been bettered except in the field of syntax. The well-known linguist Bloomfield has revealed his indebtedness towards Ashtadhyayi of Panini. In fact, the other Indian thinkers like Bhartrihari, Yaska, Udbhada, and Anandavardhana are still source of inspiration for modern linguists. In India, until 19th century, descriptive method only held a distinct place in language studies. Western scholars followed the historical and comparative approach. It was Ferdinand de Saussure, the Swiss scholar, who took the right attitude towards descriptive studies. In fact, Saussure had acquaintance with Sanskrit language before. In his well-known book, Post De Linguistic, published in 1916, language study had been divided into synchronic and diachronic. The significant signifying relation advocated by Saussure represents the Shabda-Artha relation in Sanskrit. Kunjuni Raja, a modern Indological research. Kunjuni Raja, the most remarkable Sanskritist of 20th century, started studying Sanskrit with his uncle C. Kunjan Raja, a well-known Sanskrit scholar and Sanskrit poet. His first doctoral thesis research was done under the supervision of Kunjan Raja at the University of Madras. Later, Kunjuni Raja was at the SOAS, University of London, where he got his second PhD in linguistics, working with John Brough. His thesis, Indian Theories of Meaning, is considered as one of the best works in that area. He has authored around 30 books and more than 200 research papers. And his books include the much acclaimed The Philosophy of the Grammarians with Harold Coward and The Contribution of Kerala to Sanskrit Literature. Kunjuni Raja was also the editor of the early volumes of the New Catalogus Catalogram, a remarkable ongoing project in manuscripts research. He has also the recipient of the President of India Award for outstanding contribution to Sanskrit. The discovery of Sanskrit by the modern West in the 18th century was an epoch-making event in the eventful history of knowledge. European scholars brought out great uplift to Sanskrit research. Indological research until that time was more or less moving along narrow lanes and rules. Indian cultural past was thrown open to scientific inquiry, utilizing traditional as well as modern tools of research. This paved the way for the emergence of new disciplines like comparative philology, modern linguistics, comparative religion, etc. Critical acumen, anxiety for accuracy, Persians and industry, close examination of data, evidence of the tendency to taking things for granted, avoidance of the tendency to take things for granted, sobriety and fairness of judgment are principles that go into the making of a modern research scholar. It is in this context that Raja is placed, for he has been a veritable modern Indological researcher. Raja belongs to an era that began to attempt studying India's cultural legacies with the help of modern tools. Raja highlighted, familiarized, analyzed, and evaluated the systems of knowledge embedded in Sanskrit with the true sensibility of a modern thinker. Indian theories of meaning. Indian theories of meaning, the work is the second doctoral thesis of Raja, submitted at London University. The famous linguist John Brough was his research guide. The book examines Indian semantic thoughts in a fresh perspective. How do the various schools of thought view meaning? How do they satisfy the problems aroused by linguists? The book investigates these questions and examines them elaborately. Raja mainly discusses the various theories of communications based on Vyakarana, Nyaya, Purva Mimamsa, Poetics, and Buddhist philosophy in the light of semantics, the branch of modern linguistics. Primarily, Raja denotes that the study of meaning is an area of interest for linguists, anthropologists, rhetoricians, philosophers, psychologists, and rhetoricians. The abundance of material for the study and the lack of a uniform meta-language are the two problems that he faced while writing this book. Raja has expressed the objective of this study that the purpose of this work is to bring out in a systematic form the linguistically relevant views on the different aspects of meaning given by the various schools of thought in ancient India. The topics, the meaning of meaning, Abhidha, the primary meaning of the word, Hoda, the theory of linguistic symbols, conditions of knowing, the meaning of a sentence, the comprehension of the meaning of a sentence, Anvita Abhidhana and Abhihidanvaya, Lakshana or metaphor, and Vyanjana or suggestion are being discussed in 7 chapters. For this, Raja examines various topics of Indian philosophy, grammar, and literature. The 3 vyaparas of meaning, like Abhidha, Lakshana, and Vyanjana, and their divisions are taken for detailed discussion. The theory of the Skoda presents as the theory of linguistic symbols. The philosophic observations of Bhartrihari have a decisive space in this work. Akanksha, Yogyada, Sannidhi, the 3 conditions of knowing, the meaning of a sentence is also subjected to a thorough discussion. The process of Shabda Bodha, or the comprehension of the meaning of a sentence, is a prominent area in Indian linguistic philosophy. The theories of Anvita Abhidhana and Abhihidanvaya are also discussed in it. The Dhvani theory and its various elements have been examined in the chapter titled Vyanjana or Suggestion. Hoda theory. Raja presents Spoda, the theory of Bhartrihari, as one of the prominent theories of Indian linguistic philosophy. To quote, "The theory of Spoda is one of the most important contributions of India to the central problem of semantics in general linguistics. It maintains that a word or sentence is to be considered not as a concatenation made up of different sound units arranged in a particular order, but mainly as a single meaningful symbol." Raja continues, "The term spoda is derived from the root put, which means to burst, and it is defined in two ways. In its linguistic sense, it is normally defined as that from which the meaning bursts forth, that is, shines forth. In other words, the word as expressing a meaning, that is, vachaka. It was Bhartrihari, the great grammarian philosopher, who developed and systematized spoda theory. Bhartrihari's works are Vakyabadiya, Uncompleted Commentary of Mahabhashya, Shringara Shataka, Vairagya Shataka, and Niti Shataka. Raja points out that some ideas on this theory can find in Haridatta and Nagesha Bhatta, the earlier grammarians. According to Bhartrihari, speech and thought are only two aspects of the same speech principle. Ekasyaiva atmano bhedau shabdarthav avrithitau. Here, Raja cites the verse of original text as reference. Besides this, Raja cites another proof for the above principle from Aitareya Upanishad. Vangme manasi pradishthita mano me vaji pradishthitam. And the first sloga of Raghuvamsha, Vagarthaviva samruptau. That scientific approach in citing reference made this word so authentic. Raja notes that it was Patanjali who gave the first reference of spoda theory. To quote, "Patanjali distinguishes between two aspects of words, the spoda and the dvani. The former is the permanent element in the word and may be considered the essential word, whereas the latter is the actualized and ephemeral element and an attribute of the former. The spoda, as described by Patanjali, may be a single letter, that is varna, or a fixed pattern of letters and is the no. It remains constant and is not affected by the peculiarities of the individual speakers. Even when pronounced by different speakers with different tempos, its linguistic value is the same." Raja presents Bhartrihari's discussion about the nature of the spoda as follows. To quote, Bhartrihari begins the discussion on the spoda theory with observation that words and sentences can be considered under two aspects, as sound patterns or as meaning-bearing symbols. He says that in meaningful language, linguists recognize two entities, both of which may be called words. One is the underlying cause of the articulated sounds, while the other is attached to the meaning. A detailed discussion on how the spoda is comprehended is interesting. To quote, "The process of comprehension of the spoda is illustrated by the grammarians by means of various analogies. It is like a jeweler examining the precious stone by looking at it steadily for some time to enable him to determine its real value. He has a series of perceptions. The first one gives him a general knowledge of the gem. Each subsequent perception helps in revealing the real nature of the gem until the last perception, aided by the various impressions of the previous ones, helps him to grasp the real value of the gem completely and clearly." Bhartrihari has given another analogy. It is that of a student trying to learn a verse by learn a verse by heart by reading it repeatedly. Yathanuvaka shloko va sodhatvam upagacchati avrutya natu sagrandha pratyavrutti nirupyate. Raja also presents classification of soda. He has tried to clear the misconceptions on the theory of soda. Raja also presents the linguistic philosophy of Bhartrihari. The concluding notes of this topic is remarkable, which discusses the famous verse of Bhartrihari, Swaravrittim vigurute madhau umskogilasya kah jandvadaya kulayadikarane kena shikshita. Anvita-abhidhana theory and abhidhita-anvaya theory. Comparing Anvita-abhidhana theory and abhidhita-anvaya theory, Raja states that the theory of Anvita-abhidhana is very acceptable in the viewpoint of modern linguistics. Raja explains this. The meaning of a sentence is made up of the individual word meanings and their mutual relation. According to the Anvita-abhidhana theory, both the individual word meanings and their mutual relation are conveyed by the words themselves. But according to the Abhidhita-anvaya theory, the word convey only the individual word meanings. The mutual relation is conveyed by the word meanings and not by the words. Among modern writers on linguistics, wouldn't seems to represent the Anvita-abhidhana theory, for he says that in determining the nature of a sentence, no addition to what is expressed by the words should be assumed. Polemizing against this view, Paul maintains the Abhidhita-anvaya view that such an assumption is usually necessary. The commonplace statement in modern linguists that the sentence is the unit of speech is comparable to the Anvita-abhidhana theory. Bhatta school of Mimamsakas and some of the Nayayikas advocates Abhidhita-anvaya theory. According to them, the meaning of sentence is a concatenation of the individual items expressed by the words. The individual words bear their own meaning, but it can be comprehended separately. The comprehension of a sentence is carried out in such a way that on hearing of a sentence, firstly, we get the separate meanings of the words, one after the other. Secondly, the meaning of the sentence is comprehended according to the three factors, akanksha, yogyata, and sannidhi. Raja illustrates, when we hear a sentence, we have first an understanding of the separate meanings of the words, one after another. Then these word meanings are related on the basis of akanksha, that is expectancy, yogyata, that is consistency, and sannidhi, that is proximity, and we arrive at the unified meaning of the sentence as a whole. The expression of the individual word meaning precedes the knowledge of the logical connection among them. The different isolated ideas expressed successively by the words are put together by the collective memory of the listener. Samuhalambana smriti. The individual word meanings are remembered separately until all the words are heard. Then there is a simultaneous cognition of the sentence meaning, in which all the word meanings are properly related to one another on the basis of akanksha, yogyata, and sannidhi. According to the Abhidhita-anvaya theory, on the other hand, each word as it is being uttered contributes to the meaning of the sentence, which is revealed step by step, becoming clearer and clearer with the utterance of subsequent words. The discussion of Abhidhita-anvaya and Anvita-abhidhana theories almost concludes by presenting the perspective of Mukula Bhatta, the author of Abhidha Vritti Madhurga. According to him, both theories contain partial truth. In the viewpoint of words, Abhidha Anvaya theory is more correct. On the contrary, if looked at from the viewpoint of sentence, Anvita Abhidhana theory is more preferable. Mukula Bhatta accepts a combination of two views and calls it the theory of Samuchaya. Abhidha is the first among the fourfold system of Indian theories of meaning. The primary meaning of a word is significant that it becomes the foundation of other systems of meaning like Lakshana and Vyanjana. In Indian theories of meaning, the discussion on variant aspects of primary meaning of word is given. At first, Rajat discusses the Shabdabodha theory, the well-known method used for learning the relation between words and objects meant by them are mentioned. Contextual factors like Artha, Prakarana and classification of words, Yaugika, Rudha, Yoga Rudha and Yaugika Rudha have been elaborately discussed here. Metaphor is almost known to all world languages. In Sanskrit, it corresponds to Lakshana in general sense. Raja provides a big portion on it in his masterpiece book, Indian Theories of Meaning. Raja analyzes all the features of Lakshana and stresses the motive element in it, which is unfamiliar to other disciplines of theory except poetics. Following features are thoroughly examined by the author. Definition of metaphor, conditions for a metaphor, the normal and the actual meanings in a transfer, Gauni, repeat or qualitative transfer, Jahal Lakshana, Ajahal Lakshana, Jahad Ajahal Lakshana, Shuddha, Saroba, and Sadhyavasana. Classification of Lakshana, incompatibility of the primary sense, Nirudha Lakshana or faded metaphor, motive element in Lakshana, compound words, and Bhartrihari's views on Lakshana. Raja introduces metaphor as secondary significative function of words. It is interesting to note how he defines this. To quote, if we take the word as denoting its normal primary meaning, the sentence may become nonsensical in the context. This produces a psychic resistance in the listener, and there is a sort of break in the flow. It excites attention and requires interpretation for understanding the purport. The actual referent of the word has to be taken as different from its normal one, but in some way connected with it, either through similarity or through some other relation. This function of the word denoting a referent different from its normal and primary one, but somehow related to it, is called Lakshana or Upachara. Other terms like Gauni Vritti and Bhakti are also used to refer to this secondary significative function of words. Of the three essential conditions in Lakshana, the third one, sanction for the transferred sense by popular usage or a definite motive justifying the transfer is not accepted by all philosophers. The first one is the inapplicability or the unsuitability of the primary meaning in the context. The second one, some relation between the primary and the actual referent of the word. The last but not least is the sanction for the transferred sense by popular usage or a definite motive justifying the transfer. Raja observes that other disciplines of thought are not considered the motive element in Lakshana, but rhetoricians paid great attention on it because they accept vyanjana. The third function of words. Raja opines that motive element in metaphorical expression is not clear and dependent to contextual factors. Here, in the case of the well-known example Gangayam Ghosha, it is the motive element. The village has the qualities of sanctity and coolness associated with the sacred river. Suggestion. Suggestion or vyanjana is the backbone of the dhvani theory. It is common that most of the art lovers approve and apprised the theory of dhvani. Anandavardhana, the founder of dhvani theory, was himself a sahridaya. He wrote Dhvanyaloka, focusing the perspective of sahridaya. Another name of Dhvanyaloka is Sahridayaloka. Thus, the title itself emphasizes the importance of Sahridaya. Primarily, Raja was a Sahridaya. His writings and their titles are evidence for the same. Even while examining the language, he usually discusses on the language of poetry. In Indian theories of meaning, also, some may think that he is committed for establishing the theory of suggestion. Unlike Mimamsa, Vyakarana and Nyaya, the theories of poetics are considered of lesser importance even in the perspective of Indian scholars. Here, Raja supports its validity and acceptance in language behavior also. Raja explains that Anandavardhana got the spark of Dhvani from the well-known linguistic philosopher Bhartrihari, who laid the foundation of Dhvani. Bhartrihari has already discussed the contradictory nature of the utterance and its meaning. The context is a decisive factor in the comprehension of the meaning of a sentence. Raja also points out that Anandavardhana focused on literary meaning. Actually, it is a limitation, but in the case of poetics, it was a great impetus. Anandavardhana developed it in such a way that it covers almost all doctrines of literature till then. First of all, Anandavardhana established the existence of the third meaning, which is quite distinct from the primary and secondary meaning. Raja stresses on the necessity of another realm of meaning as a medium of manifesting the whole emotional world of humanity. Poetry or literature utilizes all the possibilities of a language. To quote Raja, it is a matter of common experience that an utterance may mean much more than its literal sense. The Nayayikas and Mimamsakas are interested more in accuracy and precision in the use of words, which they want to analyze objectively, than in the fullness of expression and in the possibilities of extending the range of meaning to the domain of the inexpressible, are satisfied with the normal literal sense. But the poets and the critics who deal with the totality of human experience cannot neglect vast portions of language behavior. While describing the existence of the another meaning or further meaning, Raja presents it as a socio-cultural meaning. He also points out that under the term meaning is concluded not only the information conveyed, but also the emotion induced. This naturally necessitates the assumption of suggestive power for language. Vyanjana and Dhvani. It is interesting to note how Raja differentiates the theory of Vyanjana and the theory of Dhvani. Anandavardhana is concerned only with poetic language and therefore omits many of these elements of speech from his field of observation. He is concerned only with the suggestion of element that is of aesthetic value, though Vyanjana, in the broadest sense of the term, embraces all such elements. It is only in its restricted sense as applied to poetry that Anandavardhana studies the problem. His aim is to establish the doctrine of Dhvani which is vyanjana applied to poetry. Let me conclude. Indian theories of meaning provides a major discussion on Indian semantic theories in the viewpoint of modern linguistics. For this, he proficiently makes use of all grammatical, philosophical, and literary traditions of India. Moreover, the detailed bibliography given at the end of the book will definitely do a great help for the research scholar who is interested in further studies in semantics. In the year 1963, Indian Theories of Meaning was published by Adyar Library and Research Center, and the second edition came out in 1969. The second edition of the book was reprinted in 2000. Rajan mentions the increased demand of the book in the preface of the reprint. The reprint of the second edition of Indian Theories of Meaning is designed to meet the continuous demand from scholars of Sanskrit, Indian philosophy, literary criticism, stylistics, and hermeneutics in India and abroad. Even though hundreds of theses are being published, it is very rare that such an acceptance and attraction of scholars has been obtained by Indian Theories of Meaning. Thank you. Thank you for the golden opportunity. Thank you for the patient listening. Thank you all.
Thank you, Dr. Arambiga, for a scholarly presentation. Now it's a time for discussion. Now I invite our chairman of today's session, Dr. P.C. Murli Madhavan, to lead the discussion. The participants can post your queries, comments, views, and all in the chat box, or you can directly unmute and ask directly.
Dr. Jyothi, actually, I want to invite Professor Shashirekha from Osmania University, Hyderabad. She is in the, I am seeing her name here. If she's available, as a senior there. Professor, I want to get her remarks on our today's lecture. Professor Shashirekha, she's not there. I'm also very happy that some of our leading professors in philosophy, the subject we are discussing today, there are several people, those who deserve attention in this area. Philosophers are there, literary critics are there, so many from different point of view, it can be discussed this regarding the meaning of Indian concepts and on meaning, Indian theories of meaning. Professor Nessie Daniel, one of the leading professors of Indian philosophy, or even our philosophical subjects, and Professor Srikala Nair, who is a frequent visitor of our Kandalur platform. Both the scholars are here. I would like to hear something from them because they were from the top to bottom. They were attending the lecture. So I request Professor Daniel and also Professor Srikala to give some of your observations on this presentation.
All right. So I was enjoying Professor Madhavan's beautiful introduction and the rendition of his student, Arambiga. I have seen her as a student. But before all that, let me also make this opportunity to pay homage to this wonderful professor, Professor Kunjuni Raja, whom I have seen as a student, as a very young girl, while I was doing research in Madras. I went to Adyar Library. At that time, he was in Adyar. And then he looked up, you know, he was, as rightly mentioned by Professor Madhavan, he was surrounded with books, heaps of books, and he looked up in a very disinterested fashion. And then he asked me, are you from Kerala? And then I said, I had very, very weak roots in Kerala. So I said, yes, I am. And then he said, Okay, so you are a philosopher. What kind of philosophy are you doing? Then I said, I'm working on Western knowledge analysis. He again looked down. He wasn't interested. And then that was the end of the conversation. And again, my memories go back to Rama is here, probably the older generation in the SSEOs remembered our orientation classes where Professor Madhavan has taken interest to bring Professor Kunjuni Raja. And you know, all through his lecture, it was monologue. Like he wasn't addressing anyone else other than himself. He was talking to himself. He was addressing to theories as though he is seeing them for the first time. You know, that is the beauty. He wasn't trying to teach anyone. He was not engaging in a dialogue. It was a monologue. He was talking to himself, if you all remember. That is the beauty of the scholar. I've seen this in Professor Unni also, our former vice chancellor. Anyway, let me come to the topic as such. So thank you, Arya, for that rendition. But some of the remarks that probably I should make is it was beautiful. But then I think, you know, theories were a bit jumbled up. And also my suggestion is that if you remember, Professor Murali Madan, I was suggesting that we should make a bridge between Sahitya and philosophy. And probably that would have helped. Because, you know, a lot of Kavi Mimamsa is to be taught to philosophy students and a lot of philosophy has to be taught to the student of Sahitya. And this, once again, I'm reminded of this need. So probably my suggestion, my humble suggestion, probably Professor Madhavan can make fine suggestions on this, like, you know, a philosophical underlining. For instance, when you say that Nayayika theory of meaning is referential, like, you know, you should quickly make a reference to their ontology. Why is it that their theory is referential theory? You know, there are standard theories of meaning like idealist, referential and all that on the Western side. No, I'm not saying that you should bring them to your stage, not at all. You can stay within Indian theories of meaning and then play fine. But my suggestion is again with Mimamsakas, when you spoke about Abhidhanvayavada and Anudhavidhanavada.
Abhidhanvada, yes.
See, these are two theories. Again, you can take to their fundamental positions on language and interpretation, particularly with regard to the interpretation of the Vedic text. And how a particular theory, why is it that Prabhakaras was holding on to their version? And, you know, I think, you know, a bit of more reasoning with the help of ontology might make your presentation more beautiful. Otherwise, I mean, of course, it is perfect from, you know, you have said everything, all that has to be said. But, you know, as a novice, probably you can improvise your presentations in these fashions. Otherwise, I heard a lot of Bhartrihari Spota and and also, like, you know, instead of presenting what Professor Kunjuni Raja has said, like, you can also intervene and then step in and say that where he went wrong, where you liked him, kind of. Like, we want to hear the young speaking on their own voices. This is all that I have to say. Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity.
There are several university teachers, those who are handling this subject in different fashion in their PG level studies and teaching and research. They are already in the platform. So I am not inviting by name, mentioning the name. They themselves can come forward and have their own opinion. They can speak in Malayalam also, English and Malayalam, whichever language they find suitable or accessible and convenient, they can use that language. Language is not a barrier. Some people will have some more convenience in English or sometimes in Malayalam or some Sanskrit or something like that. You can select your own language and let our, if you have something to say on the subject, now you can come forward and you can speak. Professor Daniel, she is there or not, I don't know. I'm not hearing anything. I'm not seeing her name now. But Professor Shashirekha is there. She had some another program today, she told me. Perhaps that may be the reason that she is not found. Professor Srikala, you have mentioned bridging Sahitya and philosophy. Surely, yep. I accepted, and my work, my complete work was when I was in Kaladi, I was doing a lot for that purpose, taking our grammarians and taking our Nayayikas and even Baudhas and all those people, the so-called philosophers of India, and even to Western philosophy, no doubt about it. We had, as you know very well, my department was doing a lot in bridging East and West, perhaps, and the ideologies and like that. And as Bertrand Russell has told, that the literature becomes valid and authentic because of the sound basement of philosophy. Literature is built upon a literary form, a literary work is being built upon a very strong basement of philosophy. So because of philosophy, it becomes acceptable. It becomes authority. It becomes valid. And in turn, the philosophy becomes more acceptable and a subject of liking. How it comes? It is because of it is presented through literature. So through literature, the flavor of literature comes to automatically, and the philosophy becomes, even though philosophy, when you speak about philosophy, automatically the first impression is that, oh, it is very tough and very dry, very difficult. It is a very hard to crack. So people have this type of notion. So the philosophy becomes very acceptable. When you read Narayaniyam, when you read Bhagavata, the philosophy has been presented, the Advaita philosophy or Vishishta Advaita philosophy or Dvaita philosophy. Such philosophies are being presented in a very beautiful way through literature.
Exactly.
So that is why, that is in Bhagavata, we say that bhaktya yuktya vibhaktya cha neyam bhagavatam smritam. Professor Srikala may be knowing all these things. There is always a bridge. Actually, there is no necessity of bridge even, because it is already put in one. Two things are put in one. And it is, one side is philosophy and the other side is literature.
Exactly.
In that way, our all creative works, we can see when you go through, you can see this type of, even some local, what we call some literary works, so to say, not a classic one, I would say, even modern time, when you come across some literature, some literary works by the ordinary people, it is pregnant with the philosophy.
True.
So philosophy, you cannot avoid. Philosophy is always, it is just like Brahman. It is always there, all pervading. It is colorless, odorless, formless, tasteless. It always there. It is. You are within that, and so it is inseparable. Both literature and philosophy, it is inseparable. But you mentioned about bridging it, because people nowadays, they feel that these are two independent and strange things, which cannot be compared to, or which cannot be put together, or which cannot be read together or studied together. So this type of problem is there. So to avoid that, we have to do some work. That is what I feel.
Exactly. Yeah, particularly for student community, those who think that we'll have to raise disciplinary walls between literature and philosophy.
Yeah.
We need to make them aware that the success lies in erasing of these disciplinary walls.
These walls are created by human beings. And actually, as I told you the example, Bhagavata, when it is written, when it's composed, the Rishi never thought that there should be a barrier in between. There should not be any wall in between. There is no wall at all. When you read Aho Aho Bhagyam Aho Bhagyam Nandagopa Vrajavasam Yen Mitram Paramanandam Purnam Brahma Sanatanam. See how beautifully the love affair of Krishna and Radha or other gopis and the final emancipation are put together in one single sloka. How beautifully Vyasa has done it. He has no difference whether it is a love or a hatred or any this type of feeling or that type of feeling, whatever it may be, he says everything are put in. And he says that this is the sum total of this. So in that way, we must be trained to look into these matters of what we call interest or study. So that is very important. So students, as you told, it is very correct that we have to train them in that way. That is our main mission of teaching. Exactly. These walls should be demolished. That is what I feel.
That's right. Anyway, wonderful, wonderful discussing with you.
Okay.
I'm reminded of those older days when we used to do conferences and seminars together.
Yeah. I remember. I always remember. And you are always enthusiastic in your department. We never felt that there is a wall in between Sahitya department and philosophy department.
Oh, exactly.
We never felt it. We joined and most of the teachers, we joined together and we have very intellectual exchanges in between and very good scholars used to visit our departments and they continuously imbibe, they inculcate this kind of spirit among the seekers. So that's what we are doing. So. Even then, it was not what is expected, that has not happened, but to some extent, the possible way we have done it, that's all.
Yeah, that's
okay. Then anybody, Professor Sashireka is not here, she has not come, okay. And so now our youngsters, so many people are there, they can speak.
Sir, namaste.
Yes.
Thank you. Purnima.
Yes, thank you.
Congrats, Aryambiga, for your paper. And there is a small doubt regarding Abhihita Anvayavada and Anvita Abhidhanavada. My doubt is that, is it possible to say that Abhihita Anvayavadin's focus on the power of language, whereas, Abhihita Anvayavadin's focus is on the power of language, whereas Anvita Abhidhanavadin's lay stress on the faculty of humans to use the language. Is it correct to say like this? This is my doubt.
Yes. Aryambiga will be giving a reply at the end. All can ask the questions one after another. Then he can put it everything together and give answer. I think there is no question. It is only the thing is that some clarification, something like that.
Actually, I think you, sir, it's a doubt for, it can be discussed, I think. What is the difference between the standpoints of Anvita Abhidhanavada and Abhihita Anvayavada? Is it correct to say that Abhihita Anvayavadins lays stress on language, power of language, because a combination of the Akanksha, Yogyata, and Sanithi, and the combination of words, it is on the power of the language itself. Whereas Prabhakara say that it happens in the minds of the speakers or listeners. So, is it right to say that?
You mean that expectancy and consistency, such elements, that is Akanksha, Yogyata, and Sannidhi, they make the words more strong and more powerful.
Yes, in Abhidhitanvayavada, they say that the...
Yes. You can speak in Malayalam also. No problem. You can speak in Malayalam also. Yes.
അഭിഹിതാന്വയവാദികള് പറയുമ്പോൾ ഇവര് ഈ പദാർത്ഥങ്ങളുടെ അന്വയം വരുന്നത് അന്വയം വരുന്നു എന്നാണല്ലോ പറയുന്നത്. അഭിഹിതങ്ങളായ പദാർത്ഥങ്ങള് അന്വിതമാകുന്നു. അപ്പോ വാസ്തവത്തിൽ അത് ഭാഷയുടെ ഒരു പവറിന് പ്രാധാന്യം കൊടുക്കുകയും അതേസമയം അന്വിതാഭിധാനവാദത്തില് ലിസണേഴ്സ് അല്ലെങ്കിൽ സ്പീക്കേഴ്സിന്റെ ഉള്ളിൽ തന്നെ ഈ കോമ്പിനേഷൻ നടന്ന സെന്റൻസ് അന്വിതമായിട്ടുള്ള ബോധം ഉണ്ടാവുന്നു എന്നാണല്ലോ പറയുന്നത്. അപ്പോ നമുക്ക് ആ രീതിയിൽ ഇന്റർപ്രറ്റ് ചെയ്യാൻ പറ്റുമോ? ഒന്ന് ഭാഷ, ഒരു വ്യൂ പോയിന്റ് എന്ന് പറയുന്നത് ഭാഷയ്ക്ക് പ്രാധാന്യം കൊടുത്തുകൊണ്ടുള്ള വ്യൂ പോയിന്റ് ആണ് അഭിഹിതാന്വയവാദത്തിൻ്റെത്. അതേസമയം അന്വിതാഭിധാനവാദത്തിൻ്റെത് ഈ നമ്മളുടെ ലിസണേഴ്സിന്റെ അല്ലെ സ്പീക്കേഴ്സിന്റെ ഫാക്കൽറ്റി ഇതിനെ യോജിപ്പിക്കാനുള്ള ഒരു ശക്തിക്ക് പ്രാധാന്യം കൊടുക്കുന്നു എന്ന് പറയാനൊക്കോ. ഇപ്പൊ ശ്രീകൽ ടീച്ചർ പറഞ്ഞ പോലെ അതിന്റെ ഹിസ്റ്റോറിക്കൽ പ്രാധാന്യത്തെ കുറിച്ചല്ല, അല്ലാതെ നമുക്ക് ഈ രീതിയിൽ ഇന്റർപ്രറ്റ് ചെയ്യാൻ
ജ്യോതി. What happened?
Hello, sir.
What happened?
No, there was another call came.
Okay. Dr. Purnima, എന്റെ ഒരു ചോദ്യം, നമ്മുടെ എക്സ്പീരിയൻസ് എന്താണെന്നുള്ളതാണ്. അപ്പൊ ഈ സിദ്ധാന്തങ്ങളിലേക്ക് പോകുന്നതിന് മുമ്പ് നമ്മൾ ആദ്യം നമ്മുടെ എക്സ്പീരിയൻസ്, ഒരു ഒരു വാക്യത്തിന്റെ അർത്ഥം എന്ന് പറയുന്നത് എന്താണ്? അത് ഞാൻ പറഞ്ഞു കഴിഞ്ഞില്ല. ഒരു ഒരാള് വക്താവിന്റെ ഇച്ഛയാണോ ഇന്നത് വരണം, ഇന്ന അർത്ഥം വരണം എന്നുള്ള വക്താവിന്റെ ഇച്ഛയാണോ, അത് കേട്ട ആള് ധരിച്ചതാണോ, ഏതാണ് ശരിക്ക് ഒരു സെന്റൻസിന്റെ അർത്ഥം? ഞാനൊരു വാക്ക് പറയുന്നു, ഞാനൊരു സെന്റൻസ് പറയുന്നു. ഞാനിപ്പോ പൂർണിമയോട് സംസാരിക്കുമ്പോൾ ഞാനൊരു വാക്ക് ഒരു സെന്റൻസ് പറയുമ്പോൾ ആ സെന്റൻസ് ഞാൻ ഏതർത്ഥത്തിലാണോ ഉദ്ദേശിച്ചത് എന്നുള്ളതാണോ അതിന് പ്രാധാന്യം, അതോ പൂർണിമ എന്ത് മനസ്സിലാക്കി എന്ന് ആ വാക്യ സെന്റൻസിന് എന്ത് മനസ്സിലാക്കി എന്നുള്ളതിനാണോ, ഏതിനാണ് പ്രാധാന്യം? എന്താണ് നമ്മുടെ വേൾഡ്ലി എക്സ്പീരിയൻസ്? ഇപ്പൊ നമ്മൾ ഈയിടെയൊക്കെ ആയിട്ട് പത്രങ്ങളിലും ഇവിടെയൊക്കെ കാണാറുണ്ട്, അതായത് ഞാൻ അത് അങ്ങനെ ഉദ്ദേശിച്ചിട്ടില്ല ഇത് പറഞ്ഞില്ല. പല രാഷ്ട്രീയക്കാരും സാമൂഹ്യ നേതാക്കന്മാരൊക്കെ പല പ്രസ്താവനകളും ഇറക്കി കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ ആ പ്രസ്താവനകൾ പിന്നീട് പറയും, അത് ഞാനത് അങ്ങനെ ഉദ്ദേശിച്ചിരുന്നില്ല, എൻ്റെ അത് പ്രസംഗത്തിൻ്റെ അല്ലെങ്കിൽ വാക്യത്തിൻ്റെ ഇടയിൽ നിന്ന് ചിലത് അടർത്തിയെടുത്ത് ഇങ്ങനെ പറഞ്ഞതാണ്. ഇതൊക്കെ നമ്മൾ സ്ഥിരം കേൾക്കണ തമാശകളാണ്. വാസ്തവത്തിൽ എന്താണ് നമ്മുടെ എക്സ്പീരിയൻസ്? നമ്മുടെ എക്സ്പീരിയൻസ് എന്താ വെച്ചാല് നമ്മൾ ദ മീനിങ് ഓഫ് എ സെന്റൻസ് ഈസ് നോട്ട് വാട്ട് വി മെന്റ് but what being understood by the hearer. Ketta aal endano manasilakkiyathu adaanu aa sentence inde artham, idaanu final result. Arthathine sambandhichathum idu raja valare detail aayittu charcha cheyyunnundu. Chala individual articles ilum ee Indian theories of meaning ilum mathramalla individual aayittu kore articles adheham Netherlands ilokke publish cheytha ഒരു സീരീസ് ഓഫ് ആർട്ടിക്കിൾസ് ഉണ്ട്. അതിൽ അരിയാംബിക വുഡ് മേ ബി ഇൻ എ ഗുഡ് പൊസിഷൻ ടു സ്പീക്ക് അബൌട്ട് ദാറ്റ് ബിക്കോസ് അത് റിസർച്ചിന് തീർച്ചയായിട്ടും ഉപയോഗിച്ചിട്ടുണ്ടായിരിക്കണം. അപ്പൊ ഞാൻ പറഞ്ഞുകൊണ്ടുവന്നത് ഈ അന്യതാഭിധാനവാദമായാലും അഭിഹിതാന്വയവാദമായാലും എവിടെ എംഫസിസ് വരുന്നു എന്നുള്ളത് മാത്രമാണ് ഇവര് ശാസ്ത്രകാരന്മാർ ചർച്ച ചെയ്യുന്നത്. പക്ഷേ നെറ്റ് റിസൾട്ട് ഞാൻ ഈ പറഞ്ഞതിനോടാണ്, ഞാൻ ഈ പറഞ്ഞ വിഷയത്തിലാണ്. അവിടെ അന്വയത്തിനോ അന്യതമായിട്ടുള്ള അർത്ഥമായിട്ടോ ഒന്നിച്ചു വരുന്നുണ്ടോ, അതോ വന്ന് പദങ്ങൾ വന്നതിന് ശേഷം പിന്നീട് അന്വിതമാവുകയാണോ എന്നുള്ളതൊക്കെ പാരലൈസ് ചെയ്യപ്പെടും. അതൊക്കെ നിർവീര്യമാവും. അപ്പോ ഈ ഒരു കോൺസെപ്റ്റില് നമ്മൾ അതിനെ കുറിച്ച് രാജ പറഞ്ഞിട്ടുള്ളത് എന്ത് എന്നുള്ളത് ആര്യാമ്പിക്ക് വേണമെങ്കിൽ ഒന്നും കൂടെ സ്പഷ്ടാക്കാൻ പറ്റുമായിരിക്കും ഞാൻ തോന്നുന്നു.
ഇൻ
ദ ചാറ്റ് ബോക്സ് നോ. സോ നൗ വി ക്യാൻ ഹിയർ ആര്യാമ്പിക ഫൈനലി ആൻഡ് ദെൻ വി ക്യാൻ കൺക്ലൂഡ് ദ പ്രോഗ്രാം.
ഐ തിങ്ക് നൗ ദേർ ഈസ് വൺ റിമാർക്സ് കെയിം ഫ്രം രേണു പോൾ.
യാ.
Let her ask Renu,
you may ask the question. You can say that directly. Renu from Varanasi.
Yes.
Renu, please, if you are available, you can ask directly the question. Yes.
Namaskar to everyone. I'm sorry. I'm not very good at these computer things. So the question for me is about translation. This is the tricky part of any type of trying to search for understanding is the multiple words, for example, in the Rig Veda, which I'm working on trying to translate the Shrishti Suktams. I'm coming across the problem of multiple words. How do we come to some sort of exact understanding of something that happened thousands and thousands of years ago? So translation and multiple meanings of words are particularly problematic for me. So any suggestions, and what would Raja say to, what would he say to do in such a situation? Thank you. Well, the problem that I have is with the active translation, because you have so many, you know, the Nirukta and all of the Koshas have different meanings for one word. So how does one come to some sort of exact understanding of what the Rishis had in mind in terms of the Suktams, the Shrishti Suktams that I'm working on, to try to get a better understanding of what the Rishis are trying to communicate through the Suktams in the Veda? Thank you.
Yes, Mrs. Renu, actually, I want to tell you that especially when you speak about the Vedic hymns, when you translate, it will be a transcreation. It will not be a translation, or not at all. Mm. Because as you said, because several Niruktas and several the Koshas, they give different types of meaning for each word. And it is very difficult to translate. Even classical language, we find difficulty in translating. Translation is a very big problem, that you should be competent both in source language and target language.
Yes.
So in both, if you are fully equipped, even then, people like Kunjikuttan Thamburan and such people, those who are translated the what to speak about that. Even Max Muller and such great scholars, they have made it very clear that it is not a faithful translation. There is there is a word faithful translation, but it is an utter nonsense. No faithful translation in the world.
So where do theories of meaning come in translation? Or is there any such, is it possible? Or is translation from one language to another, and also in terms of context, thousands of years, different culture, the Vedic culture, now we're living in a modern culture, how to make it alive? Is meaning possible when you're distanced by time and circumstance, et cetera, and culture?
Yeah. Circumstances, you mean context. The text becomes meaningful because of the context. So context is more important. And based on that, you can select the proper the word in your target language. From source language, when you translate to target language, if, for example, from Sanskrit, you translate to English, according to the context, you have to find out. Context, and this I have, in my introduction, I have mentioned very clearly that context play the pivotal role. In understanding the meaning.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Anyway, it's a very tricky business.
Yeah, very tricky business. And there is no, madam, there is no faithful translation in the world.
Yes, that's why we have to revert back to the original languages. Read the Veda and the Sanskrit.
Even there is a definition for translation that when you translate, when the process is going on, when the literature which loses its mula, that's original, that is called a translation. That is called a translation. So to that extent, it is gone. That means you cannot see even a small element of mula, original text in the translation. So completely, it may be a separate, different thing. That's why I told that most of the translations are transcreations.
That's a good, that's a very
under
good
the pretext of translation, it is their own creation. That's all.
Thank you.
Especially in Vedic law.
Oh, yes. Because Vedic Sanskrit has its own, there's such a gap between the Vedic Sanskrit and the classical Sanskrit.
As you said, a word which was used some
thousands of years
back.
Yes.
In what context they have used and how it is. But still, there are some words they are continuing the meaning in Veda. You know, you know Malayalam also. So I want to tell you in Rigveda, the word ani, nail. That is the word used in Rigveda. It is a Sanskrit, a Vedic word, and that is still we are using in Malayalam.
Yes.
Dravidian language, Malayalam, use the word ani, the most perfect and the Vedic word ani is being used in that same sense.
Without any change.
So these are the things that you...
Better involved in. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Renu. Thank you. Then... Dr. Jyoti, we can go ahead now. Aryabhya, if she wants to say something, let her speak and then we can conclude. Time is gone.
Yes. Dr. Aryabhya, please, you wanted to say something?
I think Dr. Purnima is very good in hermeneutics. That's why she asked. വ്യാഖ്യാനങ്ങൾക്ക് മുരളിമാധവ മാഷ് പറഞ്ഞ പോലെ വ്യാഖ്യാനങ്ങൾക്ക് കൂടുതൽ സാധ്യത നൽകുന്നതാണ് ഇപ്പോൾ കേൾവിക്കാരന്റെ ഒരു പക്ഷത്തിൽ നിന്ന് ആലോചിക്കുമ്പോൾ ഏത് തരത്തിൽ വേണമെങ്കിലും ഒരു സെന്റൻസിനെ വ്യാഖ്യാനിച്ചെടുക്കാം. ഇതിനെ കുറിച്ച് സോഷ്യോ കൾച്ചറൽ മീനിങ് ഇത്തരത്തിലെല്ലാം കുഞ്ഞുണ്ണി രാജ പറയുന്നുണ്ട്. എനിക്ക് ഈ അനുവിതാഭിധാനവും അഭിഹിതാന്വയവാദവും വെച്ച് നോക്കുമ്പോൾ രണ്ടും സ്വീകാര്യമാണെന്ന് മൂളഭൃത്തൻ പറഞ്ഞ ആ പക്ഷത്ത് നിൽക്കാനാണ് എനിക്ക് തോന്നുന്നത്. പറഞ്ഞതുപോലെ കേൾവിക്കാരന്റെ സ്വാതന്ത്ര്യം, കേൾവിക്കാരന് കൂടുതൽ സ്വാതന്ത്ര്യം നൽകുന്നതാണ്. ഒരുപക്ഷെ സാഹിത്യ വിദ്യാർത്ഥികളൊക്കെ ആവുമ്പോൾ ധ്വനിയുടെ ഒക്കെ ആ ഒരു തലത്തിലേക്ക് പോകുമ്പോൾ നമുക്ക് ആ തരത്തിൽ അതിനെ വ്യാഖ്യാനിക്കാമെന്ന് തോന്നുന്നു അന്വിത അഭിധാനവാദത്തെ. പിന്നെ ഡോക്ടർ രേണു പോൾ രാജ ഓൾവേസ് പ്ലേസ് കോമൺ സെൻസ് ഇൻ സച്ച് സിറ്റുവേഷൻസ്. ഹി ഓൾവേസ് in editing and translating, he places common sense above all.
It is called a codified common sense.
Codified common sense.
I was talking to the research students in my university, in my department, and when they ask methodology, I told, what is methodology? Methodology is nothing but a codified common sense. I used to say that like that. And I like that word more, what we call, better than any other word, any other very similar word, you also to say.
Nice way to put it.
Yeah. So now the things are very clear, and I am very happy as the chairman of the session that a young scholar, Dr. Aryabhya, who is good in poetry, so she is a better person when you compare to other people to talk about the meanings, because a poet intending a meaning, conceiving a meaning in the mind, then only he puts the words properly. First the artha comes, when it comes outside, Shabda comes first and Artha follows it. But when you conceive something, first Artha we conceive and a poet, and then only the Shabda comes. Then you have to find out a proper Shabda for that. So first the idea comes, that is Artha. So that idea is being conveyed through beautiful words. That is what a real poet does. So in that way, Aryambika as a poet, she's a good poet in Kerala, and she is my own student, and she has done PhD under me, and I know her caliber, and she presented the paper very beautifully and touching without leaving any significant part of it. She revealed the sense of the crux of the book, that Indian theories of meaning. That is a wonderful monumental work, and no work has come after that to compete with that, to challenge the findings of Dr. Kunjunda Raja. So this is the case of both his PhD theses. The first one, contribution of Kerala to Sanskrit literature, as I told you, that even after 70 years, nobody has challenged any of his standpoints. Normally in such field, you know, when I find out something, and something as we pretend, or we believe that it is something very new that we have brought out and unearthed, and we declare that this is our finding. But within minutes or within hours, the another scholar will come and he will refute it, and he will bring some other new idea in that same place. So this is what is happening in the research field. So but normally Abhinav Gupta, one of the great researchers in the Indian aesthetics and poetics, he told that the researchers are no research has to be neglected. Nothing is totally futile. Nothing is totally to be neglected. Each dissertation is a pedestal. See, if somebody has done a research work yesterday, standing on that work, we are doing the next work. Just like we are erecting a what we call staircase. We prepare the first step, then standing on that step, we do the second one, and then the third one, like that it goes. And there is no end for that. This is called Urdhordha Maruhya Yadartha Tattvam Dheepashyadi Shrandhima Vedayandi Bhalam Tadadhi Parikalpitanam Viveka Sopana Parambara. So this is what a beautiful expression given by Abhinav Gupta. So it is what we call Nishranika, and it is a group, the what we call the steps one after another created by a human being, and there is nothing final, and nobody can say that my research is final, and after me no new things have been found out by anybody. Nobody can claim in that way. So new person will come and he will establish something more new and more fresh, and our things will become old, and new fresh things will come in the world. In every discipline, that is what is happening. And with these observations, I congratulate Dr. Aryambika for her very beautiful scholarly presentation. I think sometimes if it is in Malayalam, it is more appealing, perhaps. But our barrier is that, that is why I told it, language is not a barrier, you can speak in Malayalam also. But our listeners are from outside Kerala also. Today it is very limited people are there, but normally very good scholars, they used to attend from different states. So even people from Tamil Nadu, they cannot follow Malayalam. They feel difficulty. They want to hear in their own mother tongue. So that is a difficulty. So, but anyway, it has done well. Properly it has been done, and she has prepared well. So I congratulate her. And I also express my thanks to Dr. Jyothi. Dr. Jyothi was all the time here to help us in our as far as our platform is concerned. It should not be disturbed at any way. It should be perfectly okay. And that is a kind of great help to Kandru Shala. And I think I request Dr. Jyothi to proceed further in our program.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Murali Madan, sir. Now I invite Dr. Vanaja. She is assistant professor of Sanskrit in Vimala College, Thrissur, to present the citation on behalf of Kandalu Shala to Dr. S.V. Arambiya.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Due to some network issues, because here is heavy raining, sir, and that is why I off my video with your permission. Okay, sure. Sir, thank you. Respected dignitaries of this program, my beloved teacher, Professor P.C. Murali Madhavan, sir, a great academician, the backbone of this program, the Director-in-Chief, Kantalur Shala, Dr. Sarita Maheshwaran, Dr. Pradeep Jyothi, sir, Dr. Ajitan, Dr. Annapurna, Dr. Purnima, Dr. Shrikala M. Nair, Professor Shashi Reghan, Professor N.C. Daniel in their absentia, respected teachers, research scholars, and my dear friends, a warm good evening to one and all. It's my greatest pleasure to present the citation to Dr. S.V. Arambiga. I got many opportunities to hear many poems in her sweet voice when I was a PG student at the Sahitya Department of the Sri Shankaracharya University of Sanskrit. I remember those beautiful days now. Now, with the permission of all gathered here, I enter my duty. Kantalur Shala is an institute of higher learning and research in ancient wisdom. In the modern era, Kantalur Shala is organizing many academic programs to enlighten the new generation with ancient knowledge systems. On behalf of the 8th National Lecture Series organized by Kantalur Shala, Dr. S.P. Aryambika well presented a lecture on the topic Indian Theories of Meaning, Kunchuni Raja's Critic. With great honor and respect, Kantalur Shala highly commends Dr. S.P. Aryambika for her outstanding contribution and exemplary work in Vedic literature as a young Sanskrit scholar, poet, writer, and teacher. Dr. S.P. Aryambika is working as assistant professor in Sanskrit at MG College, Thiruvananthapuram, Kerala University, since August 2018. She had more than 7 years of experience in teaching as Sanskrit teacher at Government UP School, Poovarani, Pala, Kottayam, Kerala. She did Bachelor of Arts in Sanskrit, Master of Arts in Sanskrit Sahitya, MPhil in Sanskrit Sahitya, and PhD in Sanskrit Sahitya at the Sri Shankaracharya University of Sanskrit, Kaledi, Kerala. She is also UGC NET qualified in June 2012. She participated in various international and national seminars and presented 9 research papers and published 5 research papers. She is a poet and an active writer in Malayalam and has been honored with national level award Yuva Puraskar from Kendra Sahitya Academy in 2015 and received more than 11 state level awards, including Kanakashri Award from Kerala Sahitya Academy in 2012. She is also a jury member for selection of Kerala Sahitya Academy Kanakashri Award in the year 2017, and one of her poems has been included in the syllabus of Kerala University. She has participated in various national level multilingual poet meets. Some of her literary contributions are Ratriyude Niramulla Janala, Kattilodunna Thivandi, Thonniya Poluru Pula, collection of Malayalam poems, all published by DC Books, and Mannankattiyum Kairiyilayum, collection of Malayalam poems published by Kairali Shlokarangam, Pala. She is regularly writing poems in Malayalam periodicals. She has written lyrics for the inaugural song of 56th Kerala School Youth Festival in 2016. Lyrics for the title song of Kerala Chief Minister's Program on Doordarshan, Sutarya Kerala. Lyrics for a musical documentary, Amme Abhayam. Lyrics for devotional audio CD, Mahaganapatim and participated in the audio CD project of Kalidasa's Megha Sandesham and Kumara Sambhavam. She is also the secretary, Kairali Shloka Rangam, Pala, Kottayam, an organization promotes Akshara Shlokam and Kavya Keli. She has been honored with many awards and recognitions, which includes Kendra Sahitya Academy Award, Yuva Puraskar in 2015, and Kerala Sahitya Academy Kanakashri Award in 2012. She has also participated in multilingual Kavi Sammelan International Festival of Poetry in Delhi, organized by Kendra Sahitya Academy in 2014. Presented poems in Northeast and Southern Poetry Festival, organized by Kendra Sahitya Academy in 2014. Participated in All India Young Writers Festival, Agartala Tripura, organized by Kendra Sahitya Academy in 2016. Participated in national level poet meet Kavya Hotra, organized by Kala Academy, Panaji, Goa in 2016. This citation is presented to Dr. S.V. Aryambika on Saturday, the 23rd October 2021 at Thiruvananthapuram, Kerala, signed by Professor P.C. Murli Madhavan, Director in Chief, Kantalur Shala. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you all. Congratulations to Dr. S.P. Aryambika.
Thank you, Vanaja.
Thank you, Vanaja.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Madhavan, sir. Thank you, Dr. Vanaja, for a wonderful presentation of citation to Dr. S.V. Aryambika.
Thank you, sir. It's now, my pleasure.
Yeah. Now we are going to conclude the session. We invite Dr. Ajithan, who is also a faculty member of Kandalu Shala, to propose out of thanks. Dr. Ajithan, please.
So we have had a wonderful session today. A paper presented by Dr. Aryambika. The topic was Indian Theories of Meaning, Kunjuni Raja's Critique. And she has wonderfully presented her paper. And many things have been said about Aryambika, a young poet and who won many accolades. So I do not repeat all these things again. And I find two points most interesting in her presentation. One is Mughala Bhatta's stand on Anyuda Abhidhana Vada and Abhidha Anyaya Vada. He stood for a Samuchaya Vada. That I found very interesting. And another thing is that Kunjuni Raja stand on Anyuda Abhidhana Vada. He stood in favor of Anyuda Abhidhana Vada. I found that is also very interesting. And so overall, it was a wonderful presentation. And however, it falls within her area of research, so she could do more. And on behalf of the Kandalur Shala and its organizers, I extend a warm gratitude to Aryambika for her wonderful presentation. This presentation is enriched by very academic discussions participated by Dr. Srikala Nair and others. So always the presentation becomes more effective when there are more deliberations on it. So it was such a good presentation. And this session is presided over by Dr. P.C. Murli Madhavan, sir. And I extend our gratitude to you also, sir. And thank you all for your participation, patient listening, etc., and your active participation. Thank you all.
Thank you, Dr. Ajithan. Let us conclude the lecture series with Sandeep Pada. Professor P.C. Murli Madhavan, sir.
Yes. Om Bhadram Karne Bhishrunuyama Devaha Bhadram Bashyema Akshabhiryajatraha Thirai Rangai Stushtuvam Sastanubhi Vyashema Devahitam Yadayu Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Now we are concluding the session. Thank you for all for your active participation. Dr. Jyoti, Thank you, especially for the proper conducting of the session. Thank you.
Thank you. Once again, thank you all.
Thank you all.